Welcome to Chiang Mai, Thailand. Thank you for joining me today in this episode of Something to Think About, talking about the power of deception. It is such a privilege that I have to be able to share the word of the Lord with you, for I believe with all my heart it is the desire of people that have a hunger for God to find the true path to heaven. Contrary to what many say, all paths does not lead to heaven. Actually, the Lord said, straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. There are so many voices today that proclaim they know the way, but are used of Satan by offering a path that says, all you have to do is say, I believe. Now you're saved. My friend, there is more to our foundation than just saying, I believe. There was a question that was asked of the Lord in Luke chapter 13, verse 23. Then said one unto him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said to them in verse 24, strive to enter in at the strait gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. The answer the Lord gave was astounding. He said, strive to enter in. The word strive signifying that it's not going to be easy, but it can be found. The Lord spoke at length about being born again. And we know from natural experience, giving birth is not an easy task. And being born again of the Spirit is not an easy task either. For we must surrender our all to Jesus Christ and press through many preconceived ideas about being born again, about the born again experience. False teachings have diluted the supernatural experience to just a confession, of faith, disregarding examples all through the book of Acts of what the born again experience really looks like. The Lord said, strive to enter in, for many, I say unto you, shall seek to enter in and shall not be able. Why? Because modern day preachers have developed an easy plan of salvation. Just say, I believe. I tell you true, my friends, that is not going to make it. Luke chapter 16, verse 16. The law and the prophets were unto John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it. This is just another way of saying strive to enter in. The word presseth in the King James Bible Dictionary means to squeeze, the act of urging or pushing forward, an urgency to reach the desired destination. But the power of deception says, oh, you don't need to do all that. Deception is causing someone to accept as true or valid, yet is actually false, whether it be outright lying or half-truth. Here is what the Lord said about the power of deception, and it is found in Matthew chapter 23, verse 15. He said, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye compass sea and land to make one proselyte, And when he is made, ye make him twofold. That word twofold means two times more the child of hell than yourselves. Proselyte is a person who has converted from one opinion or religion or from another party to another. Who is the Lord talking to here? He was talking to the religious world of his day. He was talking to the scribes and Pharisees, for they were the religious world of that day. Things have not changed even to our day, because the religious world is still deceiving people with half-truth. This is what I want to submit unto you today. There are four subjects that I want to touch on that are vital to our salvation. Any one of these left out will result in an incomplete foundation. I know the temptation to go the easy route, but when it comes to our salvation, for 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 10 says, we must be diligent to make our calling and election sure. Number one, is baptism important? Number two, what scripture would we use to baptize our converts? Acts chapter 2 verse 38 or Matthew chapter 28 verse 19. And why is this important? Number three, what does the scripture say about being born again? Number four, is there evidence to verify we have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost? I just want to give a couple of scriptures to prove each point. I'm not interested in opinions. I'm not interested in half-truth. When we study God's Word, it must be in the full context of that subject in the Scripture to be able to rightly divide the Word of truth. So here we go. When talking about the power of deception, the template Satan used to deceive Eve from the very beginning has not changed. The reason he is so good at it is because he has had a lot of practice at it. Satan is not that smart. Actually, Satan is the biggest loser that has ever been created. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? He was called Lucifer, the son of the morning. No one in history had it made like Satan. He was called the son of the morning. His residence was in heaven. He was the most beautiful angelic being that God had ever created. There is no sin in heaven. There is no temptation there. Yet even in that environment, Satan could not make it. So he is the biggest loser that has ever been in the history of creation. So don't let him distract you and convince you that he is some almighty, because he is not. He is the biggest loser that has ever been. Luke chapter 10, verse 18, the Lord is speaking here, and he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. I bet that was a sight. I wish I could have seen it. When I talk about the power of deception, it's not at all because Satan is all that smart or strong. The Lord said in Luke chapter 10, verse 19, and he is talking to his disciples and to those who are in the church. He said, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you." Where the power of deception is useful is when we can be convinced the Word of God doesn't really mean what it says. Please look at these scriptures with me. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree?" Don't take for granted, Satan knows the Word of God. And those that are used of him does too. You see, Satan is not afraid to use the Word of God. From then until now, Satan's tactics have not changed. The most effective weapons that Satan has is distraction and deception. Verse 2, Genesis chapter 3, verse 2. "And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden." Verse 3. "But of the fruit of the tree that is, which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die." Verse 4. "And the serpent said unto the woman, Ah, ye shall not surely die." You see, Satan deceived Eve, causing her to think, you see, God really didn't mean what he said. Satan and his demons, and those he will use to deceive, still use the same tactics today. Let me give you a couple of examples. And I want to give you two examples where the scripture declares its necessity. Matthew chapter 3, verse 15. "And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it to be so now." Let me set a little context in the scripture here. The Lord had came to John the Baptist to be baptized of him. John said, I need to be baptized of you. And this was the answer of the Lord to John the Baptist. Matthew chapter 3, verse 15. "And Jesus answering and said unto him, Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he suffered him." The Lord Jesus said, it is required. For he said, it has becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Mark chapter 16, verse 16. "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned." Yet there are those through the power of deception will convince people that's not really what that says. What scripture would you use to baptize converts? Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Or Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. And why is it important? Here are four scriptures where people were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ or in the name of the Lord Jesus. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 through 41. Acts chapter 8, verse 16. Acts chapter 10, verse 48. Acts chapter 19, verse 5. How many scriptures where people were baptized repeating Matthew chapter 28, 19? Zero. None. Not any. No place in the Bible was anyone baptized repeating Matthew 28, 19. Yet, 99.9% of all churches today will not baptize their converts in the name of Jesus Christ. Why? Because through the power of deception, Satan has used those who were called Bible scholars to adopt a doctrine that came from the Council of Nicaea in AD 325 through 381, that baptizes their converts in titles Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, not in the name of Jesus Christ. This was a major victory for Satan, because there are going to be millions lost because they have rejected the name of Jesus Christ. And why is baptism in the name of Jesus Christ important? Acts chapter 4 verse 12 tells us, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. How many scriptures do you need to prove that point? Is scripture going to be your foundation, or is the Council of Nicaea going to be your foundation? What does the scripture say about being born again? The religious world has many interpretations of what this born again experience looks like. Man's thoughts and opinions breed deception. But the Word of God is plain and simple. What it says is what it means. Look at these scriptures. John chapter 7, verse 37. The Lord is speaking here. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Verse 38, he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Verse 39, but this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. These ministers that say all you must do is just say, I believe, now you're saved, has just deceived you. The promise of the new birth. The Lord Jesus spoke at length about being born again. John chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 5 tells us this born again experience is essential to our salvation, which is our hope of going to heaven. John chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, or of a truth, or absolutely indeed, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Verse 5, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water, that water there means baptism. There's some that says that that has to do with giving birth when a woman's water breaks. That is so untrue, because if you look at this word in the Greek context, you'll see where it talks about a body of water where someone goes down into the water. The Lord is talking about baptism here. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. In these next scriptures, we see what the born again experience looks like. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. We see this experience poured out upon those who were waiting in Jerusalem. And this is what it looks like, Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, They were all with one accord in one place. Verse 2, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. Verse 3, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it set upon each of them. Verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I have seen with my eyes. I seen this man. We were praying for him. We were praying for him to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And he began to speak with other tongues. And he began to do this right here. He began to do this right here. And then after just a few minutes of speaking with tongues, he said, I am so hot. I am so hot. This was a Thai man, because I am in Thailand doing missionary work for the Lord. But this is what he was telling. My wife is the interpreter and was telling us that he was so hot. That's... When John the Baptist saw the Lord coming down the road, he said, there's one that cometh after me that's mightier than I. He said, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. My daughter was telling me that when she had received the Holy Ghost, she felt like she was on fire. Now, I have never felt that experience. I did speak in tongues with when the Lord filled me with the Holy Ghost, but I didn't feel that burning flame. I didn't feel that real hot sensation. Verse 4 is where the power of deception has been propagated by those who call themselves biblical scholars, and they say speaking with tongues went away when the apostles died. Some call it gibberish. Some say it's part of a pagan ritual. Some say the Bible really doesn't mean that speaking in tongues is the evidence that you have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Here are a couple of short videos. The first one is of John MacArthur. He pastors a big church in California. Thousands of people attend this church. And here he is talking about speaking in tongues.
They don't even know what it is. It's so obviously not what it was in the scripture. What it was in the scripture was known languages. Known languages that could be translated miraculously. That they would speak a language they didn't know, and then somebody would give a translation of that language they didn't know. That was clearly what was going on in the book of Acts, and that's what subsequently follows up. So they can turn it on and turn it off. They can learn the words that they say. It's a kind of gibberish that has developed its own lingo. So yeah, it's so obviously not the biblical gift.
And the other one here, the other man is called Mr. Pearl. The only reason I have him here is because he has a YouTube following of almost 200,000 people. And this video has been viewed more than 100,000 times, with him saying speaking in tongues is a pagan origin and is not of the Spirit of God. Please listen closely.
If you will look up all of the pagan and ancient religions, you will find that nearly every one of them give examples of what today would be called speaking in tongues. It was just a common practice among heathen. Now, I used to think when I was young, because I followed the Spirit of God, but I didn't understand a lot of things. I hadn't done a lot of study on it. And I was around a lot of people jabbering in what they call tongues. And the Spirit of God was clear to me that that was not a gift of the Holy Spirit that they were exercising. And now I've experienced gifts of the Spirit. I know what they are. I know the supernatural.
So these two men that call themselves ministers of the gospel are so very close to blaspheming the Holy Ghost when they call speaking in tongues gibberish and of pagan origin. Not only these two men, but thousands of their kind preach and teach the same message. Are these men so spiritually bankrupt until they cannot discern between the true Spirit of God and the working of Satan? Sure, Satan has counterfeits. Sure he does. But if we walk in the Spirit, we can discern between the true Spirit of God and the working of Satan. But these men are so spiritually bankrupt until they can't. And the reason why, and this is what I really feel, they have never received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That's the reason why they speak against it. Mark chapter 3, verse 29. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. The definition of blaspheme in the context of the Gospels of Matthew and Mark, blasphemy against the Holy Ghost, is the sin of attributing to Satan what is really the work of the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God, to be evil spoken of, reviled, railed against, as some call gibberish. There are over 7,000 languages and dialects in the world today. There is absolutely no way these men or anyone in our world today would have any idea about all of these different languages and the sounds thereof. Because there are so many that sound like gibberish that is actually languages. Please listen to these next two videos. And then I will make my point.
Something about a skunk. The skunk rolls in the grass and breaks his windpipe.
That is a very difficult thing to say it in Xhosa about a skunk. But in Xhosa it goes this way.
And here is what it sounds like without the interview. What he said in his language, which is pronounced Xhosa, which is a South African dialect, he said, the skunk rolled in the grass and broke his windpipe. So I want to tell you again, these men that call themselves ministers of the gospel are so very close to blaspheming the Holy Ghost when they call speaking in tongues gibberish. Not only these two men, but thousands of their kind that preach and teach the same message. Have they ever heard the language of angels? Would they call it gibberish also? The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, these people, I would not want to be in their shoes whatsoever. What does the Bible say? Is there evidence to verify we have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. There is an Old Testament scripture. There's an Old Testament prophecy concerning speaking in tongues. And it's found in Isaiah chapter 28, verse 11. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. Did you hear that? Isaiah is prophesying about speaking in tongues. Isaiah chapter 28, verse 11. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. I have heard people, when they begin to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it sounded like their tongue would get kind of twisted and it would not come out right. But then after a few minutes, you begin to hear that language come out. And it would be amazing to me to watch this and hear this and rejoice in the presence of the Lord as this came forth. Such a beautiful experience. Verse 12, to whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. And it's the same way today. People will not hear today. This is so true. And even still today, people will not hear it. Three times in the book of Acts, it shows and tells us the outward sign of receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost is the evidence of speaking with other tongues. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Acts chapter 10, verse 44. Peter is preaching to Cornelius and his household. They were Gentiles. Acts chapter 10, verse 44. And while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them, on all them which heard the word. Verse 45. And they of the circumcision, which believed, were astonished. As many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now how did they know that they had received the Holy Ghost? Verse 46, for they heard them speak in tongues and magnify God. Acts chapter 19, the Apostle Paul had met 12 disciples of John the Baptist, and he asked them a question. He said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said, we have never heard whether there be a Holy Ghost. And Paul asked them, well, how were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. And then Paul began to talk to them a little bit. And he rebaptized them in Acts chapter 19, verse 5, in the name of the Lord Jesus. In Acts chapter 19, verse 6, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. So I want to ask you a question. How many scriptures do you need to convince you? The apostles never preached tongues because they were well aware when people received the Holy Ghost, they spoke with other tongues. Except when Apostle Paul was teaching the Corinthian church about the administration and functions of the gifts of the Spirit, which included the gift of tongues and the interpretation of tongues. My friends, don't confuse the initial sign of the infilling of the Holy Ghost with the gift of tongues. It is the same Spirit, but there is a different function altogether. When this gift is operating, the gift of tongues and interpretation of tongues, in the church service, it is actually a form of prophecy being performed through the Holy Ghost in the church service. I have seen it happen so many times, and it never failed. My chili bumps would have chili bumps on top of them every time I would hear it, because you knew that it was the Spirit of God speaking to His church. For these gifts of the Spirit was given to edify the church, to encourage the church, to lift up the church, because we realize through the gifts of the Spirit that God is speaking to us through the person or persons that has the gift of tongues and interpretation that is given in the service. Now, I know most of you have no idea what I'm saying because you have never seen it in your church service. There is a reason why. It is because your pastor has never received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Therefore, he cannot teach those things because he has no idea of the working of the Spirit, of the spiritual gifts in the church. He has adopted the doctrine of just say, I believe, now you are saved. The confession of belief is their born again experience. But it is not, and does not even resemble the book of Acts experience, which is still in effect today and will be until the church is called away when the Lord, when the trumpet sounds for the church to come away with Him. The Apostle Paul was writing to the Corinthian church, and he set in order the gifts of the Spirit in the working of the church service. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Ghost, is writing instructions to the Corinthian church, who had already received the gift of the Holy Ghost, and he is instructing them how to use the gifts of the Spirit in the church service. God will use tongues and the interpretation of tongues to speak to the church, for these gifts were given for the edifying of the church. And if you read 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 5, I would that ye all speak with tongues, but rather that you prophesy. For greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh with tongues, except he interpret, that the church may receive edifying. But the initial baptism of the Holy Ghost, you can read the Apostle Paul's explanation in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 2. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries, except when the gift of this of tongues and interpretation of tongues is working in the church service. Then it is meant for the church, for the edifying of the church. I'm still talking about the power of deception. The Lord Jesus has a name for those who disregard His word, even to make light of it. Matthew chapter 7, verse 15. Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. What the Lord just said here, these people has the appearance of being religious, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. The Apostle Paul had something to say along this same subject here. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13 and 14. Verse 13, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Verse 14, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. You see, this is the power of deception. These men that call themselves ministers of the gospel, that call speaking in tongues gibberish or a pagan origin, it is because they are so destitute of the true Spirit of God. They cannot discern between the true Spirit of God and the working of Satan. Yes, Satan has a counterfeit to tongues. I have seen it and heard it with my own ears and my own eyes. I have seen it and heard it. But because I have the Spirit of the Lord, I can discern the difference between the true Holy Ghost and the working of Satan. Verse 14, one more time. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. So when these people start talking about the Word of God, that speaking in tongues is gibberish or of pagan origin, they are deceivers. And they are wolves in sheep's clothing. And Satan is using them to deceive you. I know many of you are not going to agree with this. It's not up to me whether you agree with it or not. I have given you the Word of God. I have given you the Word of God. How many scriptures does it take to convince someone, whether it be the Word of God or man's opinions? Because man's opinions breeds deception, especially if they are destitute of the Spirit of God. Thank you for joining me today. This is something to think about, the power of deception. God bless. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, amen. Thank you.